I just want one clarification. All the objects that you showed us, excepting that one from Coimbra, they were all manufactured, prepared, made in Goa?
In Goa.
All of them. None of them were imported.
These that are showing, we believe they were all made in Goa, and we are looking at Goa with different boundaries, right? Through the centuries, Goa is Siddharth Goa, then we have the old conquest, then we have the new conquest over a period of time. So we're looking at Goa and the surrounding areas that must have been the places where these objects were crafted. Yeah. So we're looking at silversmiths, goldsmiths, maybe who were around the city of Goa, what we call old Goa today. Sorry. What we call old Goa today. But it could also be that they were commissioned around the areas that were not directly under Portuguese rule at that time. It could be the Deccan area, which was still with the Bijapuris. It could be the Vijayanagar Empire. Because we have examples of beautiful embroidery, like in the image of the infant Jesus, we have a little dress where we have examples of embroidery that were done by Indian embroiderers. We know because there is zari, zardozi elements in the embroidery. So we know that, you know, there were people who were doing this work, may not have been directly the Goa that we know, but must have been from surrounding areas.
In India.
In Indian artists, yes. No. We may have in our collection one or two that may have been made by European artists, but majority of the objects, what you've seen here, were made locally. But we don't know who the artists were.
And one more small question. The image that you showed of the, you know, the crab and the cross from Coimbra.
Yes.
Caption sort of gave the impression that that is believed to be the actual cross.
It's believed to be the actual cross which is then encased in silver. Yes, it's believed to be that cross. And it is a very sought after object for various international exhibitions. So we also came to know of it because we were looking at a catalogue of objects connected to St. Francis Xavier. So, I mean, if they were just maybe inside a convent, unless you're a researcher, you are not exposed to all these objects because they might be in a sacristy and not everyone has the opportunity of, you know, seeing these objects. So even I feel this collection, which was originally the Basilica, is more accessible now because it is in the museum, because many more can see it.
One more question. I've seen that some of the things that you have here have been donated by people, and lots of Goans have, you know, statues like these. What is the law relating to this? Are people, if they have ancestral statues, are you supposed to declare it, or is it illegal if you keep it? I mean, what is the law?
So if it is yours, you can keep it. I don't know exactly what the law says, but now there's been a law that says you need to declare whatever you have which is of antique value, but still it's very ambiguous. It's still very ambiguous. So if it belongs to you and it's been inherited, if you want to declare it, you can. But I think the right people, because then you have to go through the National Monuments Act.
There is no danger of someone coming and confiscating it if you don't declare it.
I really don't know. I really don't know. So I don't know how to answer that question.
I think some of the your questions, some of the prevailing feeling amongst people who actually possess some of those antiquities is that should they declare it, then there is a very high possibility of at some point in the future a law coming in towards surrender, which is why many of them
true. And it's still a very ambiguous law. I think at the time that there was some rumor of it becoming a law, even the ASI were not sure about how to go about the Goa ASI I'm referring to. We're not able to give the right kind of advice as to how to move forward with this. As Una says, yes, you know, the fear is always there that if you declare it, and then it at some point we need to surrender. It's tricky.
Siddharth, your first slide, or the slide which had three images, non-Francis Xavier related, the rightmost one, which was of the shepherd, and you said it's one piece of ivory.
It's carved out of palm.
How large, how tall? General.
About 3 centimeters. Little more. Yes, that's about it. That's the size of the object. Yeah. And it's very intricately carved. And there are some museums around the world, even British Museum, Victoriana, that will have fantastic ivories from Goa in their collection. And we even have the Good Shepherds. The Good Shepherds are very, they're very rare. The production of Good Shepherds are very rare. There might be just maybe 10 or 15 around the world. And this is one example, but the Tree of Life is missing in this one. So I don't know whether it originally had and it got lost somewhere, but right now it does not.
Also, the casket reliquary.
Yes.
The fact that it remained in London and now is in the museum implies that it no longer holds the relic.
No, it does not hold the relic.
So, do we know the story behind that? From when to when? What kind of relic it held?
We don't have any information related to when. From when there was a relic in there and when it was taken out from there, just that the reliquary was what was handed over to the museum when the museum was set up. But no previous documentation on it. There are many more pieces maybe in the Basilica and all around the churches of Goa, which are Jesuit, that were formerly Jesuit churches of, built during the Jesuit period in Goa. And I'm sure there are, you know, I think the Jesuits were able to commission extraordinary works of Christian art, and they also, I believe, assimilated and accepted the Indian artists' interpretation of the objects and gave them free hand to do, you know, very subtly, but gave them the freedom, because we see Nagas coming up in art objects, we find the lotus is a more modern image, like the example of the Virgin on the lotus. But we also have in the museum collection cruets with Nagas as handles. So I think there was a lot of assimilation and acceptance and freedom given to the artist to interpret but make the final product for what it was meant to be, but with a lot of freedom to put in those Indian elements into the art.
So maybe we should clap for the Jesuits. What do you think?
Definitely. So they are, and a lot of work that has been done over the years. I think in the Basilica there is this beautiful image, silver image of St. Francis Xavier. Father Patricio, you know, it's in the sacristy now, but at one point I have old images of the tomb of St. Francis Xavier where it was meant to be right at the top, and it must have been moved from there to the sacristy when they were undertaking some works in the past, and is now in the sacristy. But again, a beautiful work of art. If ever you will get an opportunity to see that, it is really astounding and fantastic work. Any more questions related to the objects? Father's seen the museum, so he knows the collection also.
Yeah, Natasha, first of all, I was very impressed. One of the aspects that I really appreciated was the Indian influence on these art objects, as you mentioned. And to me, listening to you, what a great opportunity to bring about this awareness among people that we are who we are today because of this cross-fertilization of ideas and thoughts. Dastur, did you say his name? Dastur?
Dastur,
the Naga, the Lotus, Mary in a Sari. We have grown. We have so much to contribute. So instead of fighting, we have so much to learn from each other.
So when I think art is the, you know, is the way through which we can also break so many barriers and be more accepting of our cultures, of our heritage, of our religious backgrounds, but come together. And I think that the art speaks out, you know, in the best way possible, how we should assimilate and accept.
Yes.
Islam, video of gold, money, natural.
I didn't get your question.
Did we have any natural or international exhibitions on the exhibits till now, or are you planning to?
So the objects from the museum collection, especially the reliquary coffer, has traveled for international exhibitions through the Museum of Christian Art. It's gone to Japan, I think in 1999, for an international exhibition over six cities in Japan it traveled. So along with the reliquary coffer, there were another six objects from the museum that went. It was an exhibition dedicated to St. Francis Xavier. So that is, and it went again to Belgium and Australia. So it went to three exhibitions. No other object from this series has gone, but the reliquary coffer has gone. And let me also tell you how the objects go for international exhibitions. So it's not just the organizing committee of that exhibition that comes and approaches us. They do approach us directly. They discuss and tell us what they would like for the exhibition. And then we have to follow a procedure. In fact, they need to follow a procedure where they talk to the National Museum in New Delhi. And all the objects that are sent for any international exhibition through a museum has to go via the National Museum. So we have to follow that particular procedure. Our objects are sent first to Delhi, to the National Museum, and then from there to the destination wherever the exhibition is, and it follows standard procedures of insurance and loan documents that need to be signed for the duration of the exhibition. What we call a courier needs to accompany the objects right from the time they leave the museum to the time it's handed over to the exhibition organizers in that country till it goes into the display case, and then the courier returns. So the courier sometimes is from the museum or the local museum or from the National Museum, but there has to be somebody representing that object or objects till its final destination, and likewise when it comes back. So that is how we loan objects for exhibitions internationally and nationally. We would love to have just finished one project of upgrading our museum. Our exhibitions like these take a lot of effort, finances. We have to dream big, and we need to. And have the right kind of space and security, loaning agreements. Everything needs to fall in place. You have to get a larger framework to work with you. But it's possible. It's possible. Because recently they had an exhibition in Bombay and Delhi at the two main museums, the CSMPS in Bombay and National Museum Delhi, where objects were loaned from the British Museum and from Indian museums. So it's possible here as well, but just that we all need to, you know, move up to that level of getting international objects, because they demand a lot in terms of display, lighting, your humidity controls, your security, everything needs to be at that level. So yeah, right now we've done it at the museum, but we would like to dream it and also plan in the future international exhibitions.
The Museum of Christian Art here, is this owned and managed by the diocese, or is there a link with the National Museum? Or
so we are a project of the Archdiocese of Goa. And the operations and managing committee is representatives of the Archdiocese and the community. But we are also a registered society. And we are registered, and we have to register with the ministry and follow those procedures as well. So we are not directly linked to the National Museum, no, unless we have to collaborate on some things. So we belong, it's a project of the Archdiocese, to answer your question.
What are the
collaborations, say, with the Museum of Christian Art in Mumbai, the one that's in the Goregaon Seminary?
So, we've not had any collaborations so far, but we are open to collaborations in the future, yes.
And what are the challenges you all are facing? Is it footfalls?
Is it
funding? Is it organizing? Is it security? I know there have been problems, but can you give us an idea of what are the challenges?
So, challenges are many, starting with the funding. Which is the biggest challenge if you want to have a museum of a particular standard, I think. And
many of you have seen the new museum after we have upgraded, and many of you have not. So I think you all need to come and see, because we really tried to bring it up to the level of an international museum in terms of display, in terms of lighting, in terms of visitor experience. We are trying and we are still working to improve it even more. So that is the first challenge. Funding becomes the biggest challenge, because if you want to be at international standards, you have to also spend, and how will you get the money? So for this project, we got money from the Ministry of Culture in New Delhi under a particular grant, and we also had to reach out to the community to support the museum to achieve what we wanted to achieve. And it's an ongoing, you know, we would continue to need support for the various events, activities, you know, of particular standard. You can do things randomly. We can do, we've done events, even during the pandemic, online events like the Collaborative Learning Cafe. We have also done online sessions, which is something that we do to build awareness. But if you need other things like concerts or workshops or seminars, you need to have adequate funding for it. If you want to bring out a publication, a research publication, you need funding. Maybe not large amounts, maybe smaller amounts, but for everything you require funding. So I think funding is the biggest challenge. Also for a museum to remain alive, I think people need to come. You know, and I don't know, it may be both ways, but I think the people of Goa have not yet seen the museum. You know, so it's an afterthought. But I also give people of Goa, or all of us, the benefit of the doubt, because we have not come up in a museum-going culture. We travel abroad and visit all the museums. Why can't we go and we check out all the museums here? Good, bad, interesting, not interesting. There are so many, there are at least 10 that we can count on our fingers and say, but have we been there? Because all these museums have preserved part of our Goan heritage in them. And we need to know what we have. And then we need to, you know, show around our families, friends, when they come over from other states. We need to be proud of our heritage and take them. Yes, we take them to Old Goa. We see the most important. We need to. But we also need to see what else is there. So we also do these heritage walks of the Holy Week. We don't do Old Goa because it's so vast. We can't do it all. So we specify the Holy Week. We come to the ruins of St. Augustine's monastery. And there's such a lot of history and architecture to admire there, to understand what it must have been and what it is today, and even to understand the excavation process that was undertaken by the ASI right from the 80s to the early 2000s, and why was Queen Ketevan's relics found there, how did they reach there. That is all explained during a heritage walk like we have. We look at St. Anthony's Chapel. Some of us know, some of us don't know where it is, but it's on the Holy Hill. It's a beautiful chapel. There's the Chapel of Our Lady of Rosary. There is the Church of Santa Monica that was destroyed, which is where the museum is. So there's so much to see. Now we can do our bit, but we also need the people from this, from our community to come in to benefit from all this. So I think the footfalls is like, is the next big challenge for us. How do we get people to come into the museum, you know? Yeah, you do ads and you say come to the museum and do some promotional matter. We have social media, but is everybody on social media? Maybe not. Is everybody reading the newspaper? Maybe not.
Yeah.
So, you know, we are struggling with this. So,
I'm just looking to find that path
to get the community, because the museum is not only for tourists. The museum is for the community. The community should be actively involved in the museum's activities. You can volunteer your time, you can, you know, you might have some skill that you might want to share, and that can be done in the museum. You can have a training workshop, you can have an art and craft workshop, you can do a filmmaking, a documentary on old Goan churches in Old Goa, teach the younger children how to make photographs of objects. You can do a variety of things, but we also need resource people, and we would like to tap the local community to come and join us as volunteers, join us as interns, and be part of this whole MoCA initiative, because it's not just mine, it's not mine, I'm just one of them, but it belongs to the community. So that I think is the other challenge, and I think if we address these two challenges, you know, we'll be able to achieve so much more. Yeah, the Archdiocese Heritage Museum in Bombay, it's a much smaller museum, but they take so much pride in it. Why not we take pride in what we have here in this museum? Because it is a museum of Christian heritage, but yes, we are highlighting the Indian influence. conferences on this day now. So we would want more people to come and look at it.
The museum is open now?
The museum is open every day, 10 in the morning to 5 in the evening.
And which is the weekly?
We are open every day.
Every day?
Every day.
10 to 5?
10 to 5 every day, and with no break as such, so visitors can come in at any time.
What is the connection with the Gulbenkian?
With the Gulbenkian Foundation? So the Gulbenkian Foundation came in the early 90s to support the whole putting together of the museum, right from the identification of the art objects to the display in Rush Hall. And so they were the technical and financial assistance came in for them for the setting up of the museum. I always get this question, is whether they fund the operations. No, we don't fund the operations. That's not part of their agreement, and that's not part of something that they do. They don't fund operations for any project around the world. They fund a particular project, like they have now also supported the museum with technical and financial assistance for this project. But till that of the project, yeah, the operations and the running is with the management. And over the years, they have supported the museum at various points. So they produced the catalogue for the museum, a very detailed catalogue of the collection. So we needed their support and their guidance and their expertise for the production of the catalogue. My training also was part of something that was done by the Gulbenkian, where I was given exposure to so many of the national museums, where I did my internships, got exposure to how they manage their museums and large museums. So you get an understanding, you come back, and then you work with the challenges. Of course, large museums have got funding and we don't, so we had to cope with that. But I think we are in a good place now, just that we need to grow. So to grow, it's not only about having a permanent space and a permanent exhibition, but to do much more interesting things. You know, have temporary exhibitions, we want to have a conservation center for conservation of art objects. Yeah, we have here, like I'm doing this year, who's done a training in conservation with a British lady. But we need a proper setup, a proper center where we can take in the trained people doing conservation. Conservation is a science, it's a course. It's like we do our degrees in medicine, we do our degrees in education, we do our degree in philosophy, theology, whatever. Conservation is again a science. It's not because I like painting that I become a conservator and then I just mix and match the colors and repaint the statue. That is not conservation. So I think I'm so glad I have this platform to also talk about the do's and don'ts. I've been associated with the museum now 15 years, but I'm not a conservator. So I might be able to analyze that there is a problem with that particular sculpture or painting, it's flaking off, or there is some insect attack, and be able to put aside that object so that it's not along with the others. But I cannot go and start treating that object. That's not what I'm trained to do. So I will not do that. I will call in the experts. I call in the conservators to come, check, analyze, give their report, then start work. And document the work from how it was, to what is happening in between, to what is the finished work after it's over. So before, during and after, document it all with photographs and written reports that we keep with us. Because today, I know what I'm doing, what the conservators are doing. I leave the job or I might get retire or whatever. The next person who comes in will not know what has happened to that object. When was it last conserved? Who did the conservation? What paints did they use? What pigments did they use? So all this needs to be documented. So I think conservation is something that the museum wants to set it up and do it right for Goa. You know, because we have so many churches, so many objects lying in need of the attention. But also let me share with you that it's an expensive process. It's not, just like I said, it's not just repainting or fixing, it's not just a carpentry job or an artist's job. It needs a lot of procedure, and that's what makes it expensive. So we have to think about it, but I feel we are in that position now where we want to move towards a conservation center. So the museum having a permanent space, having a conservation center, doing temporary exhibitions, and creating more awareness and building this knowledge on Christian heritage in Goa and its preservation.
What does classify a museum, an item to be a museum?
75 years for an antique. But you might have a museum of, you have a science museum, you have a customs museum, so you have different museums, museums showcasing different objects. So in our case, our period is Indo-Portuguese history at present. So we are talking about the Portuguese period in Goa from the 16th century to the middle of the 20th century. We also would like to expand on that now and move into more contemporary, taking in more contemporary pieces into the museum, maybe for our temporary galleries. But there is no specific, I think, depends on what kind of museum you want to have. No, it's a museum of Christian art. These are some of the objects connected that I showed you today that were connected to his life. So we have some objects there, but they are from the 16th century to the middle of the 20th century. Is, yes, so that object was correct. He passed away only recently, but he commissioned that object in the 1960s. And that is, I think, because of the workmanship and it being the one of the greatest and last that we remember, master carvers in ivory, Vaman Zo. I think we want to distribute to all the other artists that we did not know.
Dasha, we have educators from North Goa and South Goa here. How can we, you, challenge them to get the museum going culture and to be assimilated by the students whom they teach?
Okay, so it is not to challenge but to welcome them to the space, first by themselves to come and see the collection, to see how they can link it to their syllabus that they have in their schools, whether it's science or maths or environmental studies or geography or history or art. So there are so many subjects that you can tackle in the museum. You can teach one aspect of what is in your syllabus through an object in the museum. You can teach about history and the discovery of the sea route to India and how the Portuguese came here and what they did through some objects. You can teach about art and the different colors that were used originally, because most of our sculptures in wood are called polychrome sculptures. So what is polychrome? What are the colors? What are the pigments? How were they made, you know, originally? What do we use today? What is ivory? From where do we source ivory? You know, so for different age groups, you can do so many things within a museum. So, of course, now the children are not in the classroom environment, but they can be brought whenever we get back to, you know, the children going back to school, or even now, they can be taught through presentations, but linking it to the museum. How was the ivory carved on, but why is ivory banned today, and why is it not used to carve? So, we can talk about all this through a museum object. We have a sedan chair, which is a palki, that was used by priests in the past. What is a sedan chair? Have kids of today seen a sedan chair? They might have seen a palki with the gods being carried, but have they really seen a sedan chair with a person seated in it being carried? So they don't understand it. So through a classroom, we can, the teacher first coming, the educators coming in, they'll look at the objects and then they can either do it themselves, plan a lesson themselves, bring the children and have the lesson there, or we can, you know, sit with them, plan their lesson, have it in a more interactive way. So in interactive way, then they also impart some knowledge and then through an activity. It can be a quiz, it can be a puzzle, it can be a poem that you write, it can be an essay that you write, or it can be so many creative skills that can be brought together through various activities and teaching in a museum. So I think music can be taught in a museum. Yeah, when I was interning in the Museum of Azulejo, they were talking about some azulejos and about stars, and then they went into Mozart the composer and said he was of a particular, he was born during a particular period and these types were made in a particular period. So, you know, that's how we can bring these connections. But that's up to us and how, I think that's the true work of an educator, to bring the links between your syllabus, your lessons and what you see around you and how do you bring it together. So, Shantini Ketan is not the only place where this can happen. It can happen anywhere. So, museums are one of the places, I think, where learning happens. When we did the restoration of the Church of Santa Monica a few years back, we had people then coming in, walking in, looking at the church, walking out, and I said, they don't understand the work that has gone into this. So we need to put the photography documentation. So we made a short slideshow, which runs on our TV screen. So when children come, or even adults come, they look at that, and they say, oh, this was how it was. This is what you're doing. This is how a painting looked before, now how it looks. So these are the things that they start looking at and appreciating. Even if you talk about one object in a museum when you bring a child, it is enough. It's a memory that we take back. So sometimes we have groups of, in the past, we had groups of 100 children coming into the museum space at one time. We can't do justice to it, to educating them or having engagement with them. How can the teachers, and they go back with no memory. So what we try to advise the educators is plan your visit, inform us, and come maybe in smaller groups. And if you can't come in smaller groups, if you are coming in larger groups, then we can give you 5 different things that 5 different groups of those 100 can do, and rotate them for half a day at different monuments, and then you can visit the museum, the ruins, the church, and engage them in an activity at every point. So we can do all that, but that kind of feeling that I want to come into a museum and learn all the holy and, you know, be part of it, and also share it with the children. So schools, colleges, all of us can come.
You all had a collector's day once for children.
Yes. So Frederick was also part of that collector's day. When he came with his children, we had once a collector's day, but once we had a young collector's day. So we encouraged children to come and show what they collect. How many kids collect anything today? Very few.
They collect cars.
They collect?
Cars.
Yeah. Some of them collect cars, some collect. My son collects pencils. Now he's losing interest, but he collected pencils. So what do you learn from pencils? How they are made? Where was this pencil brought from? Which country? So you can go and trace the country. Or, you know, Nataraj pencils. So you go back and you can check what is the origins of Nataraj pencils. So it's not only museums and museum-worthy objects that we learn from. We can learn from shells and stones and geology. And there's so much that we can learn from anything that we collect. Just that interest has to be built. So yeah, we were planning another young collector's day. Virtually.